Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's say it loud enough that Gwen can hear us up above. Good morning, everyone. My name is Michelle Norris. I am a contributing columnist for the Washington Post and the founder of the Race Card Project, but I'm really here today as a dear friend of Gwen Ifill. I am pleased and honored to serve as the mistress of ceremonies as we celebrate Gwen Ifill with the 43rd stamp in the Postal Service's Black Heritage Series. How many of you have already got your stamps? It feels so good to say that. Gwen was one of our nation's most respected and beloved journalists. She was so much more than that. She was also one of the most beautiful people who walked this planet, beautiful inside and out. She was also a dear friend of mine, so it is a special honor for me to be here this morning. She was indeed my sister friend. And it's a triple honor for me because my parents were both postal workers. So. And my mother, Betty, who I hope is watching this, has every single stamp in the Black Heritage Series. So. To everyone who is watching on Facebook Live, thank you for tuning in. If you're sharing on social media, and we hope that you are, please use our hashtags. That's hashtag Black Heritage Stamps and hashtag Gwen Ifill Forever. Let's help spread the news of this wonderful day. As we begin this ceremony, I want to ask everyone to please stand for the presentation of colors by the Postal Service Inspection Service Honor Guard and the National Anthem, which will be performed by the Metropolitan AME Music and Creative Arts Ministry. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise.
Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven rings, rings with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus along the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in thy path, we pray, lest our feet stray from the places where God, where we met thee, lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Thank you to the Honor Guard, and a special thanks to the AME Music and Creative Arts Ministry, and also to the church for their hospitality this morning. This was Gwen's church home. It was her place of spiritual renewal and uplift. There is a pew in this wonderful sanctuary that bears her name. And so it is so appropriate that we are here gathered in this sanctuary today. I also want to thank our next speaker, because this is his sanctuary. It is Reverend William Lamar. He's the pastor of Metropolitan AME, and he was a very dear friend of Gwen's, and we welcome him to the podium now. Reverend Lamar, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Beloved, I greet you in the name of our God, who is the grand architect of the universe, the maker of all things seen and unseen. I greet you in the name of our ancestors who surround us, and we are grateful for their presence. To the bishops of the church, the reverend clergy, federal officials, state officials, Madam Mayor, brothers and sisters, all. Many black people who do well, who achieve a modicum of financial success, or political success, or status of any sort at any level, mark their prosperity by running away from the masses of black people, by sprinting away from black cultural and social traditions, by galloping away from black organizations, by scurrying away from black churches. They have no time for black neighborhoods. They have no time for black schools, no time for black joy, no time for black pain, no time for black victory, no time for black defeat. These, our beloved brothers and sisters, do not rest and cannot rest until they have graduated from the University of Blackness. And they display their degrees of complete assimilation with the utmost pride. I was Gwendolyn Ifill's pastor. I am Gwendolyn Ifill's pastor, Reverend Dr. O. Urseel and Eleanor Ifill's little girl. And Gwen did not seek, nor did she accept the tantalizing offer to graduate from her Blackness. Gwen found gifted Black women and opened doors for them that she had to kick down. Gwen sat in this church Sunday after Sunday with no entourage, no hangers-on, singing in the choir, paying her tithes, organizing programs, and lending her power to facilitate our growth. She radiated with the Black beauty and dignity of our mothers and grandmothers every time she moderated a presidential debate, every time she signed off on Washington Week and the NewsHour. Gwen owed a debt to our ancestors, a debt of excellence, and she paid it in full. Gwen was part of a theological reality and a historical reality that took the settler colonial and imperial America of Jefferson and Washington and Madison and Adams, men who wrote about liberty and peace but grew strong on slavery and violence, a land they desired to be controlled only by propertied white men. Y'all quiet, but it's true. Gwen and our ancestors twisted the reality of the so-called founding fathers through fighting and pushing and pressing, through uncompromising excellence and indefatigable courage. The founders of Imperial America never intended for Gwen to be Gwen. But the founders of the African Methodist Episcopal Church did intend for Gwen to be Gwen and for a million Gwens to follow Gwen Ifill. Beloved, the psalmist said it best. The stone that the builders rejected, oh Lord have mercy, has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Beloved, preachers traffic in imagination, and if you will give me just a moment, I hear an ancestral conversation between two ancestors whose images grace Black heritage stamps. Mother Harriet Tubman turns to Gwen and says to Gwen, "Baby, I hear you got a stamp." And Gwen turns to Mother Harriet and says, "I do." And then Gwen says to Mother Harriet, "Let's meet back here when they unveil the new $20 bill."
And let the church say amen.
Let the church say amen. Amen. Thank you, Reverend Lamar. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we now have a special honor and a special proclamation to share. We are joined this morning by the Honorable Mayor Muriel Bowser of the District of Columbia. She has a special proclamation. Please join me in welcoming Mayor Bowser to the stage.
Well, good morning, everybody, and praise the Lord. Pastor Lamar, thank you for having us in the beautiful metropolitan AME. I am pleased to be here to represent 700,000 Washingtonians, and I'm proud to say that I am Gwen Ifill's mayor. We claimed her, we loved her, and we miss her so dearly. As you heard from the pastor, Gwen was a longtime Washingtonian and member of this church. She was extraordinary and quite ordinary in all the best ways. She credited the AME church for instilling in her a can-do attitude that took her to the heights of her profession, but endeared her to so many people as a wonderful sister and friend and colleague and neighbor. It is so fitting that we are here today to honor Gwen and celebrate her life and her achievements. We are also honored to be joined by our forever Attorney General and so many people who have been committed to our country. And who knew Gwen's exceptional skill. Gwen said that it was in church that she learned about politics and learned to love politics. Her presence on and off camera, her contributions to political reporting, her presence representing all of us in rooms, on stages, in conversations, in debates, simply cannot be underestimated. We thank you, Gwen, and we pay a simple tribute to you in mere words, but in big feeling and gratitude. Today, we gather to celebrate the groundbreaking journalist Gwen Ifill. It is a fitting tribute that the United States Postal Service honors her life, her contributions, with a commemorative Black History stamp. Gwen was a longtime Washingtonian and faithful member of the historic Metropolitan African Methodist Episcopal Church for 30 years, where she gave generously of her time by serving the Bethel Historical and Literary Society and singing with the Voices of Inspiration Choir. Gwen, being charitable in spirit and resources, bequeathed a sizable scholarship endowment to help advance the educational pursuits of Black children in Washington, D.C. She began her distinguished career in journalism at the Boston Herald, where among the stories she covered was the state of education in the aftermath of Boston's tumultuous busing program to desegregate public schools. Gwen's nuanced, knowledgeable, and insightful presentation of difficult issues led to an extended and illustrious career, including time at the Baltimore Evening Sun, the Washington Post, and the New York Times. She became the first woman and first African American to moderate a major television news and public affairs show in Washington, D.C., and became the co-anchor of the PBS NewsHour. One of the joys of my job is issuing proclamations for exceptional Black women. Today, I proclaim January 30th, 2020 in Washington, D.C., Gwen Ifill Day.
Thank you, Mayor Bowser. What a tremendous honor, and I hope all of us remember this day every year going forward as Gwen Ifill Day. We are fortunate to have some other guests of honor in the audience, and I'd like to acknowledge them if I can. And if you don't mind standing and waving as you hear your name, we have Thurgood Marshall Jr. with us this morning. We have U.S. Representative Danny Davis. And U.S. Representative Brenda Lawrence. U.S. Representative Donald Payne. U.S. Representative Gwen Moore. We have Juliana Richardson, who is the president and founder of the U.S. History Makers. Thank you, Juliana. for bringing Gwen into our homes through all those wonderful programs. Forgive me if there are others in the audience that I did not mention. We appreciate all of you being here with us today. If you don't mind, I just want to share a few personal remarks. And you're just going to give me a little patience as I try to get through it. Because I miss my girl. I miss her a lot. And I am imagining all over the country the joy with which people will bound into the post office starting today. Give me a stack of those Gwen Ifill stamps that people will be sending in bills happily now, sticking their Gwen Ifill stamp up in the corner. This is a spectacular honor for Gwen Ifill, and talk about on-time delivery, because this happens at a moment that we needed it. It is a spectacular honor for Gwen, but it is also a fitting and timely tribute to the importance of the freedom of the press and to fair and balanced journalism. And we all know that Gwen would be using her voice and her platform to uphold these important things right now. We know if she were alive, she would have something to say about the press being cordoned off while they are trying to cover the impeachment trial on the other side of town. We know that she would have something to say about Mary Louise Kelly and the unwarranted and unjustified attacks on her. Gwen was just 61 when she died in 2016, and that phrase, fake news, was just being injected into the American vernacular, but anyone who knows Gwen knows that she would stomp that like an unwelcome intruder. Not with bombast or violence, but with grace and dignity and facts. Gwen was a trailblazer and a pace setter in journalism. She was a voice of calm and integrity. She spoke up on behalf of journalistic integrity, and she spoke out when she thought the media industry was perhaps moving in the wrong direction. I see many of her colleagues out in the audience, and there are many of you who perhaps received a tap on the shoulder, a text on your phone, a phone call, suggesting that you might want to step away from the keyboard when you were saying things on social media that perhaps you shouldn't say. She would support people. As we heard from Reverend Lamar, she was always lifting while she climbed. She was always bringing up people behind her. She took mentoring seriously, and she saw it as a verb. And there are also people in this audience today who are following in her footsteps, who stand on her shoulders, and are practicing a much more muscular brand of journalism because they follow in her path. She stood up to bullies. She asked questions that others avoided and reminded people that adjectives like racially infused or race-laden were lazy avoidances, ways to address actual racism. The year before she died, Gwen received the Urbina Press Award. And many of you probably haven't heard of this award. It is given to journalists of distinguished character who demonstrate excellence in journalism. They go to Italy and they participate in a fantastic ceremony where the entire town comes out to fete them. When Gwen received this award, she used it as an opportunity to write a love letter to journalism, and I just want to share a few of her words with you today. She says, "Journalists get a bad rap sometimes. Often it's deserved, but that is because bad news travels well. Less told are the stories of the imprisoned journalists who risk their lives and their work in Iran and China and Ethiopia, hundreds behind bars around the world. Less understood," she said, "is the work that relies on data crunching and Freedom of Information Act requests and the willingness to challenge your own government. And less appreciated is the work done by journalists who cover zoning boards and city councils and school boards, the stuff that really affects our lives on a daily basis." Gwen knew this because she covered zoning boards and school boards long before she became the TV star that we remember her as. And one of the interesting things about traveling with her was seeing the people, newsmakers, regular folk at the grocery store, the red caps at the airport, who treated her like a longtime friend. She felt like a member of their family, that magnificent smile. She earned people's trust. She had a certain approachable warmth. And she now joins this distinguished pantheon in the Black Heritage stamp lineup. Yes, Harriet Tubman. Louis Armstrong, Jackie Robinson, Frederick Douglass, Bessie Coleman, Jimi Hendrix, and Marvin Gaye. I want to be at that party. She would have called this a colored girl moment. It's the shorthand that we used when improbable things happened to us, because we thought back to when we were kids growing up in the 1960s, when America was just getting used to integration and could never imagine someone like Gwen commanding the airwaves with her grace and integrity. She left us too soon. Too soon. Too soon. But whenever we use one of these stamps, we will see her name attached to the word forever. And it will remind us that her very special brand of grace and integrity, that never goes out of style. Thank you very much. We have a special video tribute for my dear friend Gwen Ifill. Let's pause and take a look at that.
Good evening, I'm Gwen Ifill.
And with those words each evening, Americans knew they were in good hands, Gwen Ifill's hands. She was the heart and soul of PBS's NewsHour and Washington Week. She was also beloved, sister, aunt, godmother many times over, and friend to legions. The daughter of a minister, Gwen graduated from Simmons College in Massachusetts, got her start in journalism at the Boston Herald American, before moving on to the Baltimore Evening Sun in 1981, then to the Washington Post, followed by several years as a politics reporter and White House correspondent for the New York Times.
Even marginal progress could be affected by investigations in Little Rock and in Washington.
She moved to television and NBC News in 1994.
They have to find a way to work with this president for the next 2 years. Tom.
NBC's Gwen Ifill on Capitol Hill tonight.
Then, in October 1999, she came to PBS to host Washington Week, the long-running political roundtable.
Good evening.
And to become senior correspondent on the NewsHour with Jim Lehrer.
And to our new senior correspondent, Gwen Ifill. Welcome, Gwen.
Thanks, Jim. For a preview of the Supreme Court's 1999 term, how would you prioritize the needs at the border right now?
There, she added to her lengthy and accomplished body of work. In 2013, Gwen and I were honored to assume the great responsibility and joy of co-anchoring this program.
Good evening, I'm Judy Woodruff.
And I'm Gwen Ifill. Those are just some of the stories we're covering on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
On this, the first night of the new PBS NewsHour, we have a lot of news for you.
We also have a new look, but Judy and I will be bringing you the news and analysis you've come to trust.
And it was that trust, her dedication, that was her stock in trade. She was the gold standard in our business, known for a fierce allegiance and loyalty to her family, friends, and colleagues, but also to the facts.
It was wonderful to see her again, wasn't it? Really, really special. Our next speaker today, we're gonna hold on for that for just a minute because we have the moment that we've been waiting for. The moment where we actually dedicate the actual stamp. And first, I'm going to introduce Ron Strowman, who's gonna join us and lead us in this.
Well, good morning, everyone. And thank you, Michelle. On behalf of the 600,000 women and men of the United States Postal Service, it is my privilege to dedicate the 43rd stamp in our Black Heritage series honoring Gwen Ifill, one of America's most respected and celebrated journalists, whose talent and skill exemplified the important role journalists play in our free and informed society. Gwen will now join an illustrious list of Black women on stamps that include Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, Maya Angelou, Dorothy Height, Marian Anderson, Shirley Chisholm, Barbara Jordan, Ella Baker, Patricia Roberts Harris, Fannie Lou Hamer, Sarah Vaughan, Zora Neale Hurston, among others. And we are fortunate to have the Ifill family here and so many of Gwen's friends and colleagues. Thank you all for being part of this special event. Now, while we considered many venues, it's fitting that we're gathered here, for Gwen was a daughter of the AME Church, as you've heard. Her father, Oliver, and brother, Earl, were both called to the ministry of the AME Church. Her faith grounded her. It gave her strength and informed the values that guided her life. In the words of her fellow journalist, Charlene Hunter Gault, it equipped her with a moral armor. That armor would prove essential in transcending the racism and sexism she would encounter during her career. In his 1994 book, Raising Her Voice, African-American women journalist who changed history, Roger Straitmatter notes that the lives of many of the women he depicts in his book, like those of many American women of African descent, have been firmly anchored in the church, and they were drawn to journalism by a sense of religious mission. This statement might also apply to Gwen Ifill. As you've heard, she was an active member of this congregation. She loved this church. And today, there is a special pew here named after Gwen, in recognition of her faith and service to others. Generations from now, Metropolitan congregants will take special comfort in receiving the word in the Gwen Ifill pew. Now, this is the second time we've unveiled a Black Heritage stamp in this church. I had the honor of participating in a Richard Allen stamp ceremony 4 years ago, and Gwen was in the audience that day in February. Now, I didn't know Gwen personally, but she had the ability to make you feel like you did know her. It's one of the reasons she was trusted and respected by millions of Americans who relied on her to help them make a sense of the world. President Obama described Gwen as, quote, an extraordinary journalist who always kept faith with the fundamental responsibilities of her profession, asking tough questions, holding people in power accountable, and defending a strong and free press that makes our democracy work. Indeed, Gwen was famous for asking tough questions, including to President Obama. You may remember her pressing him to clarify his stance on Syria after it had used chemical weapons, or when she asked if he had underestimated the effects of the Arab Spring. Both those were quintessential Gwen Ifill moments, reflecting both her fierce independence and dogged commitment to get to the truth. In asking these tough questions of the president, she was fulfilling her fundamental responsibility as a journalist, but she was also standing on the shoulders of a previous generation of African-American women journalists, like Ethel Payne, Washington bureau chief of the Chicago Defender, who in 1954 enraged President Eisenhower by publicly asking him when he planned to ban segregation on interstate travel, one of the fundamental civil rights challenges of that era. Building on that legacy, Gwen Ifill was a remarkable trailblazer, particularly for women of color. She covered the White House and Congress and reported on 7 national campaigns for major media outlets like the Washington Post, the New York Times, NBC News, and most prominently, television's Public Broadcasting Service, PBS. In 1999, Gwen became managing editor and moderator of Washington Week on PBS, the first African-American and the first woman to host a prominent national political talk show. In 2004, she became the first African-American female journalist to moderate a vice presidential debate and did the honors again 4 years later. She was doing double duty at this time as senior political correspondent for PBS NewsHour, where she went on to become managing editor and co-host in 2013 with Ms. Judy Woodruff to form the first all-female anchor team on an evening news show. Now, if that wasn't impressive enough, she also wrote the New York Times bestseller, The Breakthrough, Politics and Race in the Age of Obama, published in 2009. The book wasn't just about President Obama. It was about a new generation of African-American leaders who had benefited from the difficult struggles of an older generation, but they were impatiently pushing for leadership in their own right. And as she wrote, I quote, "Before my eyes, I was able to witness the romance and achievement of the 1960s civil rights marches bearing fruit as the lions of the movement mingled with the up-and-comers. Gwen's desire to understand the world and her willingness to bring us along on that journey is what made her a journalist. Her many awards included a Peabody Award and various honors from the National Press Club, the National Association of Black Journalists, the Women's Media Center, Columbia University, Arizona State University, and Harvard University. Her alma mater, Simmons College in Boston, opened the Gwen Ifill College of Media Arts and Humanities in 2018. Gwen was one of the greats, a national treasure, and so richly deserving of today's honor. The 43rd stamp in the Black Heritage series was designed by Derry Noyes. It features a photo of Gwen Ifill taken by photographer Robert Severi. I think you'll agree that they captured the warmth of her personality and that amazing smile. Because the stamp is a forever stamp, it will always be equal in value to the current first class mail price. And I think it's fair to say Gwen will be in our heart forever. Now, we may have to wait a little bit longer for our Tubmans, but today we can have access to our Gwen Ifill stamp. And now, it is my privilege to ask our designated guest to join me in dedicating the Postal Service's 2020 Black Heritage Stamp honoring Gwen Ifill.
As around the sun the earth now she's revolving, and the rosebuds know to bloom in early May. Just as hope knows that love's the cure, you can rest your mind assured that we'll be loving you always. As now thou can't reveal the mystery of tomorrow, but in passing we'll grow older every day. Because all that's born is new, do you know what I say is true? That we'll be loving you always. Always. Always.
Deputy Postmaster General Ron Stroman, thank you for leading us through that extraordinary moment. And Deputy Postmaster Stroman, thank you also for your leadership. We know that you work closely with the mailing industry to help strengthen relationships and identify opportunities to improve the interactions with postal customers and to facilitate relationships with federal, state, and local agencies. We know that your team works so hard to make this day happen, and we are forever grateful. Thank you. We have some wonderful speakers this morning, and you're going to learn a lot about Gwen's life, from her family, from her coworkers, and from dear friends. And we're going to begin with Gwen's brother, Bert Ifill. Dr. Bert, I'm tempted to call you Roberto Ifill, has a distinguished career in higher education. He's taught economics at Yale and other prominent universities. He's held senior administrative positions specializing in research and strategic planning. When he wasn't on campus, he was working with the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Brookings Institution, and the American Council on Education. I never had a brother in this life, but I gained one through my friendship with Gwen. And I can tell you, he's the brother that you want to have. Always supportive, always with a kind word, always there. You know, that's how you show someone you love them, by showing up and always there. And I can say from many a game night, the person that you want on your team. Bert Ifill.
Thanks, Michelle. Well, this is a very proud day for the Ifill family. Gwen was our sister, our cousin, our close friend, confidant, collaborator, colleague, sometimes many of those at the same time, right, Judy? You cared about her, you cared for her, you took care of her. She loved you and was so proud that you were in her life. Gwen carried the torch that warmed us, even as it enlightened us. So I'm here really to give a cascade of thanks from the Ifill family, and I want to acknowledge my relatives that are here, not only Ifills, but husbands as well. So would those of my cousins, second cousins, grand cousins, whatever, please rise and be acknowledged by this great crowd. Thank you. Gwen did carry a torch that warmed us even as it enlightened us. And although the source of that light has been extinguished all too soon, it is comforting to know that its glow goes on and on in so many tributes dedicated to her memory. Scholarships, internships, awards, a whole college, and now this signal honor. On behalf of my brother Earl, my sister Maria, myself, our many cousins whom you've just met, and my wife, Giselle, I want to thank the many people that have worked so well to make this wonderful day possible. Thank you, Mayor Bowser, for your kind words of welcome. Thanks to Presidents Clinton and Obama, from whom we'll hear later, Gwen had the privilege of following your campaigns from the beginning and of chronicling your presidencies respectfully, but with a clear eye. Thank you, my good friend, Judy Woodruff, for taking time out of a somewhat busy day to be with us today. I want to thank you, my buddy DC Washington, for lifting our spirits as you lifted up every voice. Thanks to you, Reverend Lamar, and the congregation of Metropolitan AME Church for graciously hosting this event. Can I get a witness? As you've already heard, Gwen was a devoted and generous member of this church. But I want to say to you directly, Reverend Lamar, that you were ever a source of spiritual strength and support. Whenever Gwen needed you, and when she needed you most, You were always there. Yes. You know, I can't stop looking at this beautiful stamp. I want to thank the designers who were responsible for putting it together, but most particularly Robert Severi, whose stunning photograph captured Gwen in her full radiance. I want to share with you a fun fact. Bob and his terrific wife, Penny, are near neighbors of ours, and we've become good friends through this process, even when we couldn't tell each other what we knew about it. Although I'm grateful to all the participants up here on the stage in today's ceremony, I feel I have to single out just a couple for extra appreciation, Michelle Norris and Sherilyn Ifill. They were among the most important people in Gwen's life, and their tireless efforts to make this celebration so meaningful, even while leading terrifically hectic lives, were awe-inspiring. I'm almost through with this cascade of gratitude, but I want to reserve my ultimate thanks to the fine people of the United States Postal Service. Deputy Stroman, thank you for your leadership and your heartfelt tribute to my sister's life and legacy. You should be very proud of your staff, who work diligently and patiently with a sometimes bulky brother to pull this event off. I want to make particular thanks to Marisa Pettman, Claudia Daniels, Mike Henry, and the long-suffering Gladys Harrison. I also want to pay special tribute to our neighborhood mail carrier, Larry Morris, for his friendship and efficiency. You know, he's Bob Severi's mail carrier, too. I suspect he would want to be here with us, but he's probably no doubt on his appointed rounds. One last thing. Every November 14th, I send a short poem to family and close friends commemorating the anniversary of Gwen's passing. With the announcement of the Black Heritage Stamp honoree for 2020, I had my inspiration for the following poem that I'd like to read for you now. It is titled, Gwen Forever. Gwen's smile, her confident smile, compassionate, consoling, cognizant, beams out at us. Posterity has given its stamp of approval. Gwen will be with us. When we pay our bills, she will be with us. When we send a note of thanks, she will be with us. When we invite friends, family to share celebrations, when we have something to say, too difficult or complicated to express in a text or over the phone, she will be with us. Our memories, now direct and sharp, will fade over time, just as our lives will. But Gwen's image, legacy, spirit will endure.
Bert, that was beautiful. I hope that you will make copies of that poem available for us, because I think many of us would like to have it. I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, and I'm pleased to say another dear friend of mine, Judy Woodruff. Judy, as you know, is the anchor and managing editor of the NewsHour on PBS. Of course, Judy and Gwen worked together at the NewsHour as the first female anchor team for a national television news broadcast. Judy has covered politics and other news for more than four decades at NBC, at CNN, and at PBS. She was the chief Washington correspondent for the McNeil-Lehrer NewsHour, and she anchored the award-winning documentary series Frontline with Judy Woodruff, one of my favorites. She also served as anchor and senior correspondent for CNN before returning to the NewsHour in 2007. We're so glad that you made that boomerang and came back to PBS. And she was a dear friend and confidant of Gwen. In the good times, in the tough times, Gwen and I talked on the phone several times a day, and I feel like I got to know you through those phone calls. She so cherished the time together on the air and your friendship, and I always laughed at the emails that you would send to each other to make sure that you didn't show up in the same color on the set. So they had a friendship that was deep and well coordinated. Thank you, Judy.
Thank you so much. Love you. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Pastor Lamar, Postmaster General Stroman. My love to Bert and to all of Gwen's family. What an honor it is to be here in this distinguished company to pay tribute to my work sister. And this is such a fitting tribute, as you've been hearing, to know that 3 years after she left us, Gwen Ifill's legacy lives in so many ways, a college in her name, internships, several of them, and now this stamp. If there ever was a reason, as you've been hearing, to pay your bills and write those long letters by mail to give email and apps a break, this is it. This is it. A reminder of this extraordinary journalist and person, this life force, this daughter of a preacher, child of immigrants from Panama and Barbados. There was something in the water the Ifill family drank. Brother Bert, the professor and the economist, Earl, the minister, Sherilyn, cousin, the great civil rights lawyer, every family member a standout in his or her community. And Gwen, the news reporter and anchor, the interviewer, the moderator of debates, the mentor to scores, probably hundreds of young journalists, the inspiration both to those who knew her and those who didn't. We in the PBS NewsHour family mourn her daily, and we remember her with love and respect, and a number of us are here today with you to honor Gwen. She was so often the voice of our values, the compass that kept us on track when there were decisions to be made. News people are making judgment calls all the time. What to lead with? What to leave out? What needs to be said? Gwen had the brilliance and the instinct and the power to speak up at the right moment. In this time of pervasive cynicism, political polarization, charges of fake news, Gwen was a beacon of honest, fair, rigorous, and devoted reporting. She knew and lived every day of her professional life that truth matters. The powerful must be held accountable. And yes, a vigilant free press is the lifeblood of a democratic society. One of my great gifts was working with Gwen for a decade, the last several years as her partner and the first women, yes, co-anchors of a national evening news broadcast. I told the story at her service here in this church about how we decided at the outset to defy expectations that our unlikely pairing might produce tensions. Surely there'd be jealousy, a catfight. But we decided to head it all off by staying close, letting no one put distance between us. We became so close, it was like an old married couple. At first, and you heard this just now from Michelle, we would email every night to make sure not to wear the same color on the air the same day. We couldn't be the Bobbsey twins. But at some point, we began to intuit what the other was thinking. We would just show up, and our jackets never clashed. We agreed that she looked great in purple, and so this stamp is perfect. We look and we see her big smile. We remember the beautiful person, the life force that was Gwen Ifill. And I decided to wear purple today in her honor, even if we clash. And finally, it is so stirring that we remember and celebrate Gwen today in the same week we celebrate the life of Jim Lehrer, who was a mentor to both of us. Thank you.
that was beautiful. And you do look beautiful in your purple. I'm very pleased to introduce our next speaker, a gentleman with decades of public service to our nation. I'm talking about Eric Holder, the 82nd Attorney General of the United States. I think he just got a new moniker, our forever Attorney General. Mr. Holder became the first African-American U.S. Attorney General in 2009. Previously, he was the Associate Judge of the Superior Court of the District of Columbia. He went on to serve as U.S. Attorney for Washington, D.C., the first African-American in that position. And then as Deputy Attorney General, the number two position in the Justice Department, where he supervised litigation, enforcement, and administrative activities in both civil and criminal matters. Eric was a dear friend of Gwen Ifill's. His wife was one of Gwen Ifill's doctors, and it is her birthday today. Happy birthday, Sharon Malone. How wonderful that you get to share this day with Gwen Ifill Day. And Eric's family also has roots that reach back to Barbados. So I think you often called her cuz, if I got that right. Eric, please grace us with your words.
We were in fact cousins. Barbados, the pearl of the Caribbean. All you Jamaicans, Trinidadians, other islands, you're at best number two. There are a lot of Eiffels, too. That's another Bajan trait. We have big families. Well, mine's not that large, but there are lots of Eiffels. We return today to this church where 3 years ago we said goodbye to our beloved Gwen. Now, that was a sad day. Well, today is a day to remember, a day to honor. This is a day for joy. Our lives are still not as complete as they were before Gwen's passing, but there are now more smiles than tears as we think about the accomplished woman receiving a unique and well-deserved recognition this morning. Now, Gwen Ifill was a pioneer, she was a mentor, and she was an example of what is best about us. She was a consummate journalist who understood the power, but also the responsibility that went with that role. With Judy, with the panel, through interviews and debates, Gwen, a proud black woman, consistently demonstrated what it meant to be excellent at her craft. And that excellence was good for us. It made the nation better. By focusing on the acquisition of truth, she helped to shape the political dialogue that impacts so much in this country. By exploring examples of injustice, she helped to make the nation more fair. She became, because of excellence, a truly national figure. So well known that she was depicted, I think you all remember, on Saturday Night Live. Queen Latifah, I remember that one. But her stardom never went to her head. She was always just Gwen, unfailingly nice, funny, and overly, extremely, wonderfully dedicated to her friends. Now, it was clear, having left us too soon, that her talents and skills would be missed. But today, more than ever, and in this city, at this time, and on this day, the need for her is painfully acute. This is a time for journalists to be brave, demanding, unyielding, persistent, and committed to sharing truth with the nation. This is not a time to embrace equivalence over fact. These are the traits that defined Gwen Ifill as a journalist and as a person. I hope that her friends in the media will dedicate themselves at this critical hour to acting in a way that is consistent with her example. I think that it is extremely fitting that Gwen's beautiful face is on a forever stamp. She will be forever in our hearts and now will forever be in the consciousness of this great nation. Countless envelopes will go from one part of America to another with her likeness on them. I want to thank the Postal Service and Ron for bestowing upon our Gwen this most rare and deserved honor. This act will keep her memory with us and move others who did not know her as well to become acquainted with her life's work and being. Forever is a long time. But Gwen, that's how long we're going to remember and love you. Forever. I now have the great honor of sharing some more remarks from a young man who I think you all are familiar with. To those gathered at Metropolitan AME Church, what a pleasure it is for me and Michelle to join each of you and the United States Postal Service in honoring the incredible life and legacy of someone who, like all of you, we greatly admired and respected, Ms. Gwendolyn I. Ifill. It is most fitting that she would be included in our country's good, proud, and relatively young tradition of the forever stamp. Gwen was consistent in her craft. Folks, my remarks are in big letters. This is very too small. There we go. Gwen was consistent in her craft, always insightful and thought-provoking, willing to ask the tough, even awkward questions, and an intent listener. And in the process, she set the highest standard for journalism. Now, as you may know, she didn't go easy on me, and that was one of the reasons that I admired Gwen's work. Her tenacious journalism and trailblazing spirit, her commitment to truth, and her belief that progress requires a steady pattern of agitating and advocating, accompanied by an abiding faith in our capacity as people for a change. Let us all remember to follow in her example in our daily lives. To Gwen's family and many other loved ones, I hope this lovely ceremony causes the wonderful memories to swell while leaving behind the ache that lingers long after we lose someone near to our heart. Her growing legacy includes the many young, aspiring journalists who dream bigger because of the path she bravely chose, and I trust you take due pride in this and are comforted by it too. May God bless each of you as you gather this morning to reflect on a consummate journalist and an outstanding citizen. With best wishes, Barack Obama.
Thank you, Attorney General Holder, for those wonderful remarks, and thank you to President Obama and First Lady Michelle Obama for sending that wonderful letter. Our next speaker in our prestigious lineup is my friend Dorothy Tucker, the award-winning investigative reporter for WBBM-TV in Chicago and president of the National Association of Black Journalists. As Dorothy makes her way here, just a word about NABJ and how much it meant to Gwen. Gwen was a lifetime member of NABJ. There are several NABJ members I can see out in the audience today. Gwen attended the conference every year. And yes, she went to shake a leg, because that's some of what we do when we go to NABJ. But she mainly went to mentor young people. And as she rose higher up that career ladder, her commitment to NABJ did not waver, and her commitment to mentoring young people did not waver. And so, Dorothy, I know you had to get on a plane and find some distance to get here today. We are so honored that you're here to share your memories of Gwen in honor of NABJ. Thank you very much.
Thank you. In our world, Gwen was a rock star, and I am indeed honored to represent Gwen's NABJ family. As Michelle mentioned, there are a number of our members here. Will the members of the NABJ please stand? Obviously, this is just a handful of NABJ members, just a handful of the people who loved Gwen Ifill. And Gwen, as you heard, indeed loved NABJ. Gwen was inducted into the National Association of Black Journalists Hall of Fame in 2012. She was inducted into the Washington, D.C. Society of Professional Journalists Hall of Fame in 2009. She was a recipient of the National Press Club's highest honor, the Fourth Estate Award. A best-selling author, she received more than 20 honorary doctorates. And these, and you've heard many here, are just some of the many honors Gwen received over the course of her remarkable career in journalism. I'd like to believe that Gwen would be most proud of the impact she has had on black journalists worldwide 4,100 of which I represent as president of NABJ. An honest media voice, an amazing, brilliant, and strategic journalist, a role model and mentor, a woman of strength and humility. These are just some of the things that our members know and say about Gwen. Her professionalism, her drive, and her graceful way of holding those in power accountable have always inspired our members, even after her passing. She inspired us to use our platforms to boldly report and speak the truth without compromise and with dignity. Not only was Gwen considered the heart and soul of the PBS NewsHour and Washington Week, but she also represented the heart and soul of what NABJ is all about. Former NABJ President Vanessa Williams put it best when she said, Gwen was the platinum standard for political journalists, and she was such an inspiration to African American women in the business. She was a tough, smart reporter with a warm, generous spirit who never hesitated to help financially or give her time and talent when asked, whether by NABJ or by a student. Gwen's mere presence would not only light up the room of every convention, conference, or panel she attended, but it also would ignite a passion for groundbreaking journalism in many of our young members, members who have gone on to become some of the most renowned and respected journalists in the world. Members like Yamiche Elsender, NABJ's 2013 Emerging Journalist of the Year, who now stands on Gwen's shoulders as the White House correspondent for the PBS NewsHour. In a letter to Gwen for PBS, Yamiche wrote, growing up, wanting to be a journalist, the fact that you were covering the White House, that meant something. That meant that I could go and pursue the career and become a journalist. We are grateful for the role that Gwen played in helping to raise up a generation of fearless and unstoppable Black and female journalists by the example she was every day, on air and off. It is only befitting that the United States Postal Service has honored Gwen's legacy with a forever stamp. Her impact has opened the doors for so many others to live their dreams and fulfill their callings. And as long as journalism and NABJ are alive, that impact will never cease to exist. We will forever hold Gwen close to our hearts. Thank you.
Thank you, Dorothy. That means so much to everyone here, and thank you to all the NABJ members who showed out in force today. We're fortunate to have another member of the remarkable Ifill family, Gwen's cousin Sherilyn Ifill, the director, counsel, and president of the NAACP Legal and Educational Defense Fund, or as my father would say, the N2ACP, which was founded by civil rights legend and later Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall. Under Sherilyn's leadership, the organization has intensified its litigation challenging voter suppression, racial discrimination in the criminal justice system, and segregated education. It's an honor for me to present Sherilyn Ifill, Gwen's cousin and my dear friend, and an advocate for all of us.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you to the United States Postal Service, and thank you, Reverend Lamar, for this wonderful space, and thank you to all of you for being here. So to be an Ifill kid was to be most definitely not one of the cool kids. We had a funny name, we didn't have the latest clothes, we didn't have parties at our house or go on dates. No, we were the kids whose parents expected excellence in school, stressed the importance of our faith, and thought that your siblings were all the friends you needed. For Gwen especially, as a preacher's daughter, the expectations were clearly defined and being cool was not on the agenda. But today, Gwen is the coolest. Yeah, she is now part of that small group of extraordinary Americans commemorated by a United States Postal Service stamp and through her, our entire family is now very cool. What this signifies to our family, many of whom are here today, is really truly beyond words. But more broadly, what this means to African Americans, to journalists, to all Americans who loved Gwen, is what you feel in this church today. Intense love and appreciation for the acknowledgement of the life and contributions of this truly extraordinary American woman. We have all still, even 3 years later, been trying to process the loss of Gwen, the loss to our family, but the loss to our country as well. The void in our evenings at 6 p.m., the loss of that voice that made sense of the world for all of us, the loss of a guide who, with calm and clear analysis, fit the pieces of our jumbled political world into some order, the loss of her friendship. But today, Gwen Ifill forever. Nothing has done more to heal the pain of losing her than those three simple words, Gwen Ifill forever. And at this moment in our country, those words mean so much. For journalists, it is an encouraging reminder that fact-based truth-telling, solid writing, careful analysis, respectful engagement, objectivity, and determined questioning will forever be the ingredients of excellence in your profession. For Black journalists who continue to struggle to have their voices heard, to have their perspectives lifted up, to have their platforms recognized, it means that your work is not in vain and that you must continue to do the work forever. For her many mentors in the journalism world and out, it means that Gwen is still there, lifting you and pushing you and having high expectations of you. For our family, Gwen Ifill forever means that our parents' and our grandparents' struggles were not in vain. They live on in each of us forever. And it is through the integrity of our work, our connections to one another, our love, our determination to reflect the values they instilled in us, our embrace of the family business, which is service, that those extraordinary people can live in us and through us forever. And for this country, Gwen Ifill forever at this moment means that although many of the things we see around us and lament today will pass away someday, there are some things that are just enduring. Decency and ethics and professionalism, and love and collegiality and truth-telling, and real faith, touching people and connecting with them, takes the work that you do to another level, and it gives it and you the power to live forever. Gwen Ifill forever means that you cannot erase the extraordinary accomplishments and contributions that are made every day by children of immigrants, those people who have the courage to reach out and strive and make it to these shores, and who are determined to make the promise of America live on in their lives and in their families. Gwen Ifill forever means that whatever we see around us, the best of us lives on. She's still teaching us. She's still encouraging us. She's still showing us the way. And we're so grateful to the United States Postal Service for this well-deserved, but nevertheless, astonishingly cool honor. Thank you.
We're going to hear, I need a minute after that. We're going to hear from the Metropolitan AME Music and Creative Arts Ministry in just a minute, but first, we have a special video tribute from someone that you will all know, someone that Gwen covered in her capacity as a White House correspondent, and someone who also was on the receiving end of some of those very tough questions that only she could ask. Let's take a minute and watch.
Hillary and I are very proud and grateful for the chance to add our voices to all of you gathered at Metropolitan AME Church to celebrate the new postage stamp honoring Gwen Ifill. This recognition is a real testament to Gwen's integrity as a journalist, her trailblazing efforts to make the industry more equitable and inclusive, and her career-long commitment to fair, accurate, informative reporting. Gwen was a great reporter and a masterful storyteller, and she never let her desire to tell a good story outweigh her dedication to telling the truth. I know from personal experience, she asked tough questions, and she held her responsibility to the public as a sacred bond. We all miss Gwen's voice and her perspective, and we're especially grateful that the Postal Service is choosing to honor her legacy at this time, when a free and fair press is more important than ever, not just in America, but across the world. We hope you have a wonderful ceremony. We hope Gwen's example will continue to inspire and will endure for all of us who are privileged to know her, and someday for a whole new generation of journalists who will still be motivated by the same things that made her great. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thanks to them for sending that video in. And at this time, we will have the Metropolitan AME Music and Creative Arts Ministry perform for us one more time.
Great is thy faithfulness. Join with all.
That. We have heard over the course of this wonderful ceremony quite a bit about Gwen's professional life. And as we prepare to move on, I just want to share a few words about her as a person and in her personal life. It is fitting that Gwen's image is on a stamp, and that stamps are the way that we communicate and remain connected with each other. Because Gwen was one of those people that Malcolm Gladwell might call a connector. She loved bringing people together. She opened her home often. She would have her staff over for dinner. I see many of them out in the audience. She opened her home every year on New Year's Day and cooked for an entire month to prepare for opening her doors to friends. And it started in a small little gathering in her apartment in Southwest Washington, and it continued with each house, and the houses got bigger, and the crowds got bigger, and the day got longer, and it would start midday, and it would go late into the evening. So it is appropriate that we think about how we can use this beautiful stamp to remain connected to each other. We talked a lot about writing bills today, and maybe some of you will put the device down and actually send a letter to somebody. Send an actual bill, but more importantly, send a letter. My parents are postal workers, so I have always been a letter writer. I believe that if you meant it, then you should have put a stamp on it. If there is a person in your life that you have not talked to in some time, send them a letter. If there is someone who is deserving of gratitude and you just haven't gotten around to say it, send them a letter. But in the spirit of Gwen Ifill, if there is someone that you don't agree with, because that's happening right now in this country, someone who might be on the other side of a particular issue. One of Gwen's hallmarks is that she taught there was no two sides. She knew that there were many sides, and she always took a 360 view when she did research. So send perhaps that person a letter and let them know that you may not respect their ideology, but you cherish the connection with them. If there is someone who could use an attagirl or an attaboy, send them a letter. If there's someone who you think should perhaps run for office, send them a letter and tell them that. If you think that there's someone who you think can reach a little bit higher, tell them that, because that's the kind of thing that Gwen would do. Those of us who knew her were always getting letters from her, and they were very particular. She researched them. How did you find a letter, a card, a birthday card with someone who actually looked like me? Where did that come from? And that's not easy to do if you go to a Hallmark. We all know that. And because service is the family business in the Ifill family, send someone a letter in public service. And I'm not being political when I say that, because maybe you're a little arch with someone and you want to share that with them, but we all know that people who work in public service, whether it is in government or whether it is foundational work, that is hard work. They have a particular craggy side of the mountain that they must scale, and perhaps they can hear from some of us in honor of Gwen Ifill. Maybe if we send out these dispatches, we will create the connective yarn and bridges that will yoke us together in our great humanity, much like the quilts in the sanctuary. In honor of Gwen, let us send out a sea of Gwen Ifill, a sea of shining sea of stamps to Gwen Ifill, so that Bert Ifill's postman and my postman, Vincent, and all of our postmen are smiling as they deliver those letters with Gwen Ifill's face. Let us do that today in her honor. Before we conclude our ceremony, I have a few thank yous and announcements to share. I'd like to thank all of our guests and participants today for making this a truly special event and taking time out of your day, a busy day in Washington, to be here with us. Our great thanks goes to Reverend Lamar and everyone at Metropolitan AME Church for sharing the sacred space to honor Gwen. Reverend Lamar, thank you for your words. I will forever be thinking of Harriet Tubman and Gwen Ifill having a conversation in the heavens. Deputy Postmaster General Ron Strowman, thank you so much for making this day happen. Thanks to the entire U.S. Postal Service for choosing Gwen for the 43rd Black Heritage Stamp. Thank you to everyone on the team, Gladys, Roy Betts, all the rest of you that are here for making this day so special. Thank you and great honor to the Ifill family. Bert Ifill, Sherilyn Ifill, Maria Phillip, and Reverend Earl Ifill, and all of the Ifills and the husbands that are here with us today, we stand in honor and awe of all of you. Thank you so much. Mayor Bowser, Judy Woodruff, Eric Holder, Dorothy Tucker, President Obama, Michelle Obama, former President Clinton, Hillary Clinton, thank you for sending in those videos. Thanks to everyone again who made this a special day. And we owe a special thanks to the U.S. Postal Service Inspection Service Honor Guard, the Metropolitan AME Music and Creative Arts Ministry, and D.C., Washington. Thank you so much for starting us off. Everyone is invited to come to the Frederick Douglass Hall downstairs, where you can buy your Gwen Ifill stamps, and there are other commemorative items that are also for sale. As a reminder, the participants will be available to autograph programs and other souvenirs in just a few moments. That'll happen downstairs. There will be light refreshments for everyone, compliments of the church. So thank you again, Metropolitan AME, for feeding us. And I have enjoyed being your MC for this historic celebration of Gwen Ifill. It has been an honor. Thank you for all the love and support. And as we leave, Gwen's brother, the Right Reverend Earl Ifill, will conclude today's ceremony with a benediction.
Before I give my benediction, I just want to take this AME privilege to recognize my bishop, Bishop Reginald T. Jackson, and one of my best friends, Bishop C. Wright from the 9th Episcopal District, and the host bishop, Bishop James Davis, who had to leave because they're all in conference in Houston, but they thought it not robbery to come and celebrate with us here. And I want to thank you, and I also want to thank my friend, my confidant, Dr. Presiding Elder Braxton, and his wife, Dr. Braxton, for being here today. Let us all stand for the benediction. Thanks, O God, for boundless mercy from thy gracious throne above. Thanks for every need provided from the fullness of thy love. Thanks for hours of sweet communion when by thee our souls are fed. Thanks for grace in time of sorrow and for joy and peace in thee. Thanks for hope today, tomorrow, and for all eternity. And the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit be with you and your loved ones, both today and always. And together we say, amen.